Okay, good day. Today, we are looking at business documents and prime books. And under business document and prime books, we are going to be looking at cash and credit transaction. Then we are going to be looking at trade discount and cash discount. Then we are also going to be looking at source document. Then we are going to be looking at prime books or subsidiary books. Now, when you are talking about cash and credit transaction, of course, cash transaction are the ones that once goods are bought, you know, cash is paid, cash or check is paid for goods bought, or I can say cash or check is paid or received for goods bought and sold. That's cash transaction. That is, you sell an item and then you get cash, or you buy an item, you pay cash. Then credit transaction, of course, are transactions that goods are bought but paid for at a later date. When goods are bought and they are paid for at a later date, that is, the money is not paid immediately. So that's what we call credit transaction. When you buy now and then payment is not made immediately, or when you sell and money is not received immediately. So these are transactions that when goods are bought or sold, the money is not, cash is not paid or received immediately. Okay, now having said that, the next thing we are going to look at is trade discount and cash discount. Now, trade discount is the type of discount given by the seller to the buyer for bulk purchases. For bulk purchases. That is, when a buyer buys something from a seller and he buys it in bulk, and then the seller now says, okay, because you bought in bulk, let me give you discount. That type of discount is what we call cash discount. So the key word is bulk purchases. Then you now have what we call cash discount. Now, cash discount is the type of discount that is given by the seller to the buyer for prompt payment. That's the key word, prompt payment. You see that? So the difference between trade discount and cash discount are the keywords I wrote on the board. Trade discount is bulk, cash discount is prompt payment. So that is when you are buying something and you pay instantly. They give you, you know, cash discount. But you know, if you buy something and say you buy it in bulk and then they now give you discount, so it may either be that you are going to pay for what you bought later, but because you bought in bulk and they have to give you discount, you call it trade discount. Okay, having said that, the next thing we are going to look at is source document. Source document. Source document. Now the question is, what are source documents? Source documents are those documents that are fundamental. They are primary to the account of a business. That's why we call it source. They are documents that you can trace transaction of the business to. So source documents are those documents that are fundamental to the transaction of a business with customers. Now, having said that, We have number one, invoice. Invoice is a source document. Number two, we have debit note. Debit note. Number three, we have credit note. Credit note. Number four, we have check. Number five, we can say check store. And number five, we have receipts. So these are the major source documents. Like I said, source documents are those documents that are very fundamental to transaction of a business. Now, let's look at invoice. Now, invoice is a document that is sent by the seller to the buyer to show the details of the goods that is sent to the buyer. What do I mean? Let's look at that again. We said any is the document sent by the seller to the buyer to show the description, the quantity, the amount of goods that is sent to the buyer. Now, invoice is not what is requesting for payment. It's only showing the description of the goods that is sent by the seller to the buyer. Let's take, for example, that I've been doing business with you, my viewer, and then you ask me that I should supply you 10 bags, 15 shoes, 80 belts. So I have to prepare an invoice that will show that I have sent you 20 bags, 80 shoes, and 50 belts. So the document that is showing the number, the amount of goods I sent to you, the description of the goods, and their prices is what we call invoice. Okay, debit note. Of course, debit note is that note that is sent by the seller to the buyer to show that the buyer is undercharged. To show that the buyer is undercharged. Let me explain. Now, what that is saying is that, let me assume that I have sent invoice to you as the buyer. I've sent invoice. Don't forget, invoice is showing all the things I sent to you that you want to buy from me. You have not yet paid. Then I now realize that when I supposed to calculate 10,000, I now calculated 9,500. So I have made a mistake of undercharging you by writing 95. A mistake of 500. I've undercharged you 500. So the note that shows that, you my buyer, sorry, the total good I sent to you worth 10,000, not 95. So it's what we call debit notes. Okay, credit notes. Now, credit note, of course, is the document that is sent by the seller to the buyer for so many reasons. But this is one of the reasons which I want to focus on. Credit note is that note that is sent by the seller to the buyer to show that the supply given to the buyer is a wrong item. For example, you, my viewer, you requested I should supply you 10 bags, 10 shoes, 10 belts. I now went to supply you 5 bags, 8 shoes, 4 belts. You know, I have not, and I calculated based on that. I now said, I put it in the invoice that this is your money. Meanwhile, what you are requesting for from me is 10 shoes, 10 bags, 10 belts. So I have to write a credit note to you to show you that, the invoice I sent to you What I put there is wrong. Those are not the items I supposed to put there. So that's it. Okay. The next thing we are looking at is check stub. Check stub. Now, you know, in a check, when you write a check and you cut the check for someone, there is a small part of that check that is left. That small part of that check that is left is what we call stub. It will show, you know, the person, the details of the person you have given the check. So let's say the check is like this. Then that small part has a perforated place like this. So once you write the check, and usually you tear this place and give it to the person, the smaller part of that check remaining is the check stub. The person issuing the check is expected to fill both sides. So if you give somebody 10,000 naira and his name is Johnson and the date, you are expected to also put it here. So that by the time you cut the check for the person, you will have a record of what you have given to the person. So that's it. Then receipt, of course. Receipt is the document that shows that an item has been transferred from the seller to the buyer and that the buyer has paid. So receipt is the evidence of payment. Evidence of payment by the buyer to the seller for goods bought. Okay? Or evidence of payment of goods bought. So that's it. That's receipt. So receipt. So these are what we call source documents. So we call them source documents because whenever you want to prepare the account of the company, these are the documents that you can really trace transactions to. They are very fundamental to account. Then the next thing we have is prime books or books of prime entry, or you call them subsidiary books. Now, prime books. So, prime books. The prime books are one, sales day book, two, purchases day book, three, sales return day book, four, purchases return day book, five, cash book, and six, general journal. Now let's explain this one after the other. These are what we call prime books or books of prime entry or subsidiary books. Now, what is sales day book? Sales day book is the book you use to record any sales on credit. So let's say credit sales. That is, if you sell to somebody on credit, you didn't collect money immediately, where you will record it as the seller is what we call sales day book. Because it's not everybody that want to buy from you that will bring cash. Some will bring, they will not pay now. So, but you have to record it down that, Mr. Johnson bought something from me, he has not paid. So you record it in sales day book. Then purchases day book. They are books that are used to record credit purchases. Now, you know, as a business, it's also possible that you too, you will buy some things on credit. And of course, you're supposed to have your own record that, I bought table from Mr. Johnson and I have not paid. The table worth 5,000. I have to record it somewhere so that Mr. Johnson will not come and say the table is 6,000. Then, so where you record things you purchase on credit as a business is what we call credit purchases. Then we have sales return day book. Sales return day book. Now let's assume that you have sold some things to a buyer on credit, so don't forget. Now you sold 10 shoes to him. He now discovered that 2 out of the shoe is bad. He now returned it to you. You know, you have recorded in the sales day book that my customer bought 10 shoes from you and he paid 10 naira. But now that he has returned 2, he's not going to pay 10 naira anymore. He's going to pay 8 naira. So you have to record the 2 shoes he has returned and the price. So where you record it is sales return day book. So sales return day book is that book that you use to record any good that is returned by the buyer. Any good returned by the buyer. Then purchases return day book is that book that shows any good that you as a business return back to your supplier. A supplier supply you some goods and some part of it is bad. You say, I can't sell this one. I can't sell this one. Let me return it. So when you return it, you have to record it in purchases return the book. Okay, then cash book, of course, from the name, it has to do with anything that is cash. Don't forget, all these ones are to record credits. That is, the person is buying now but not paying now. I've explained the difference between cash and credit transaction. So, but cash book is that one that anything that is cash transaction, I will record it in the cash book. The person bought and paid cash, I will record it there. I bought something, I paid cash, I will record it there. Okay. And lastly, general journal. General journal is the book that any other transaction that cannot enter these 5 places, you put it in general journal. Any transaction that does not look like sales credit, credit purchases, sales return, purchases return, cash book, any other transaction that does not look like any of these 5, and you have to record it, you put it in what we call what? General journal. So that general journal is serving multi-purpose. So multi-purpose, that is when you have a transaction as a business and it cannot be recorded in any of these 5 books, you put it in general journal. So with this, I have come to the end of business documents and prime books. Thank you. So today we are looking at trial balance. We are looking at trial balance. Of course, trial balance is not an account. It's just like a book that shows the list of balances in the general journal at the end of an accounting period. So journal is what shows the list of balances in general ledger at the end of accounting period. So you know, when we have our journal and then after we have done let's say sales, cash, and then we say 2000, 200, 200. Okay. All the list of balances from our general journal is what trial balance is showing. So that is after you have prepared your individual ledger and then you prepare the general journal, then the list of balances there is what you carry to what? To your trial balance. And that's what trial balance shows. So trial balance is defined as the book that shows the list of balances, the book that shows the list of balances are the list of balances of the general journal at the end of accounting period. The book that shows the list of balances in general journal at the end of accounting period. So, having said that, what is the purpose of trial balance? Purpose of trial balance. Trial balance always serve two purposes. Trial balance always serve two purposes. The first purpose of trial balance is to check whether the account of the debit balances is the same with the credit balances. To check the account, whether the debit balances are the same with the credit balances. Okay, that is when you prepare your trial balance, you want to know whether the total of the credit side is equal to the total of the debit side, because they must always be equal. They must always be equal. Then, another purpose is that trial balance is always used to prepare financial statements. Trial balance is always used to prepare your normal income statement and statement of financial position. Income statement is what you know before as a trading profit and loss account, and the statement of financial position is what you know before as balance sheet. So your trial balance always help you to prepare trading profit and loss account and balance sheet. But now you don't call it trading profit and loss again, you call it income statement. That's according to IFRS, International Financial Reporting Standard. Then you call it statement of financial position, not balance sheet. Okay, so trial balance helps you in preparation of that. Now, when you want to prepare trial balance, these are the basic rules that I have come up with. Rule of trial balance. I call it decades. Decades. That is the rule that I have for preparation of what? Of trial balance. Decades. Now, decades means, D means debits, expenses, and assets. If that thing is an expenses, you debit it. If it is an asset, you debit it. Then credits, liability, anything that is liability, income, provision, then sales. You see that? Debits, debit, expenses, assets, credit, liability, income, provision, and sales. So that's the order that you follow. Now, let's try to look at this together.